And transiting planets are like cockroaches. And I mean that in a good way. Jesse does transiting planets for a living. The good way I mean it is for every one you see, there's another 100 out there.
Have you ever wondered what it's like to discover a brand new world? In the last 3 decades, we've found over 5,000 planets outside our solar system, called exoplanets. I'm Dr. Jesse Christensen, the lead scientist at the NASA Exoplanet Archive. This is Explore Exoplanets, The Discoverers, a series where I interview the brilliant minds behind the discovery of brand new planets. Welcome back, everyone. Just a reminder, if you're watching this on YouTube, you can also listen to it as a podcast. Head to Apple Podcasts or Google Play and take us with you on your morning commute. If you're listening to us, you can also watch us on YouTube, where you'll find some bonus graphics to help explain what my guests and I are talking about. We're returning with Dr. Bruce McIntosh, who's the director of the University of California Observatories. Welcome back, Bruce. We've just established that your least favorite fictional planet is Kepler-22b, which was featured in the TV show Raised by Wolves. So what do we know about Kepler-22b? Okay, so it's a sort of habitable planet in the show. Like, people are there, but it's rough. It's not very hospitable. It is a rocky planet with an atmosphere. There is soil. They can grow crops. The weather is bad, bordering on unlivable. And there are all of these big radioactive pits around the planet that people are trying to work out what they are. What they lead to is that the planet is hollow. It has a large hollow cavern in the center, which contains some sphere. It's all part of the mystery of the show. We learn a little bit about the different parts of the planet. So there's a tropical zone that is slightly easier to live in. It has a jungle full of plants. So it's really shown in that sense as habitable, but it's rough, right? It's habitable, but it's rough. So this is how Kepler-22b is presented on the show Raised by Wolves. So Bruce, tell us about why this and other planets of its ilk are your least favorite planets.
As you say that, I feel very bad for judging planets, but and it's amazing that the people who wrote the show picked a real planet that we know exists. And the fact that we can even do that compared to, you know, when I was a kid watching science fiction as a youth, no actual planets to populate the universe with. So that's great. The problem with using real world things, of course, is that you'll often get things wrong. And Kepler-22 is a transiting planet discovered with the transit technique. And transiting planets are like cockroaches. And I mean that in a good way. Jesse does transiting planets for a living. The good way I mean it is for every one you see, there's another 100 out there. So planets will only transit if they, transiting is when the planet blocks out the star, so it's orbiting around the star. If it passes in front of the star, you can tell that it's transiting. Only a tiny fraction of orbits will line up so that they pass in front of the star. And so for every transiting exoplanet discovered, there's literally 100 that aren't discoverable by transiting techniques. And so for the closest transiting potentially habitable planets that we know out there, there's going to be a bunch more that are 10 times closer that we don't know about because of the limitation. You asked, do I get depressed about the fact that we can get unlucky in exoplanet imaging and can't see the planet because it lines up wrong? Not at all, because the odds of that happening are actually fairly low. Okay. Do you get depressed that you miss 99% of the transiting planets?
Yes, I do.
Oh, you're a cheerful person. I didn't think you'd say yes. So there almost certainly will, by the time we're able to travel to other stars, we will have started to use techniques like direct imaging to really completely probe solar systems. And we'll find that there are a whole bunch of planets much closer than the Kepler planets that we don't, or the TRAPPIST, that we don't know about right now. And those will be the ones that, if we ever develop the technology, we're actually going to travel and visit. And you know, it's narrow and pedantic, and it's also related to the deep-seated insecurity that transits have discovered 4,000 planets, and we've discovered a dozen. But but it's also the way we discover things. It's the looking for your keys next to the streetlight problem with transit.
So is your objection the fact that they would choose this planet? So people from Earth populate this planet in the 22nd century because Earth has undergone some calamity. Is your objection that they would choose this planet in the first place because there would be much closer, much potentially more habitable planets than this distant transiting planet?
Exactly. Yeah. There's 100 of them out there that we don't know about yet.
Okay. All right. I guess that makes a lot of sense. In the show, they take some ridiculously short amount of time to get there. It's just a few decades. Whereas in real life, even the closest stars to us, if you're traveling on something like a generation ship, even at some fraction of the speed of light, it's tens of thousands of years to get to nearby stars. So the idea that you could get there in a few decades. I mean, I consult a lot on science fiction TV shows and fiction and books. Sorry. I consult a lot on science fiction TV shows and movies, and the one gimme I always give them is faster than light travel.
Right?
Like there's no way around it. You want to tell a good story in space, you need to have faster than light travel. Otherwise, you're telling a real snooze story. Literally, they're asleep for a long time. So I always tell people you can have one freebie, it's faster than light travel. After that, try to be as realistic as possible, but you can have faster than light travel. So I deeply understand your objection to them choosing Kepler-22b. Especially given how long they would take to get to it. Okay, so that's the fictional version of Kepler-22b. What do we know about the real version? So as Bruce mentioned, it was found by Kepler, and it was actually the first planet found by Kepler, or perhaps by any technique, any transiting survey, that was in the habitable zone of a star like the Sun. So the primary goal of Kepler was to find Earth-like planets in the habitable zones of Sun-like stars. And as Kepler was launched and we started to look at the data, we inched further and further towards that. Like we found rocky planets that were very close to their star. And then we found larger planets that were further out in the habitable zone. And that's what Kepler-22b is. Kepler-22b is actually more than twice the size of Earth, but it's in the habitable zone of its star. And its star is a slightly Sun-like star, just a bit smaller than the Sun. Now, that's exciting because that proved that Kepler could find things in the habitable zone. The problem with Kepler-22b is that we don't really think it's a rocky planet with an atmosphere. It's so big, it's halfway between Earth and Neptune, that it very likely has a very deep, volatile, rich atmosphere, and probably doesn't have like a thin atmosphere that could support something like Earth-like life. So it was very exciting when it was found, and big news that we could find things in the habitable zones. It had a period of 290 days, so it took 290 days to go around the star, but it was too big. So much more likely to be an ice giant or even a new type of planet that we hadn't thought of before, a water world. Much more likely to be one of those than a rocky planet. So it was a cool milestone, but didn't hit all of those boxes that Kepler was looking for. In fact, we never really hit all of the boxes that Kepler was looking for, but that's another story. So that's Kepler-22b, the fictional planet and the real planet. So let's get back to Bruce. Bruce, you've found five planets. Are you looking for more? How are you looking for them?
Right now, so a lot of my work actually focuses on the planets we've already discovered and characterizing them. There's a point past which you get bored of just counting and you want to actually see what their atmospheres are made out of. So better techniques to understand the composition of the planets we do direct imaging are giant Jupiter-y things. Mm-hmm. Are there atmospheres like Jupiter? Does that give you clues as how they form? So my main research focus when I'm not on Zoom meetings with collaborators is is trying to understand what the atmospheres are made out of. We'll start looking for more soon. So the instrument I built to go on a telescope in Chile was called the Gemini Planet Imager on the Gemini telescope. Mm-hmm. It's currently being refurbished and moved to a telescope in Hawaii, mm-hmm. with an emphasis on being able to look for very young planets, planets that are maybe almost in the process of forming, mm-hmm. through direct imaging, through blocking out their stars, through looking for signatures of planetary.
What do you have to change about it to make it more sensitive to the youngest planets?
The youngest planets are orbiting the youngest stars, which mm-hmm. makes sense. Youngest stars tend to be far away because young things are rare. The nearest baby is further away from me than the nearest adult human being because babies are rare. So the nearest baby stars are far away from the sun.
Okay.
So you need to be able to observe relatively faint stars. That's the single biggest upgrade.
Okay.
And then the planets will be quite close to their stars. So we're trying to, the thing that blocks the star, we're trying to make it smaller and tighter so we can see closer to the star.
Okay. All right. When will that be on its new telescope?
2025.
Okay. All right. That's pretty soon. That's exciting. Thinking about looking for planets like the Earth, which is what Kepler was doing, are you working on anything? I'm asking you a leading question. Are you working on anything that could potentially directly image Earth-like planets in the future?
Planets like Earth, we can't do with the telescopes on the ground, and we can't do planets like Earth around sun-like stars with the transit technique, as you mentioned. So it has to be direct imaging, and it has to be a space mission. So one of the big next things astronomy is working on is what's now called the Habitable Worlds Observatory, which pretty much does what it says on the tin. It mm-hmm. will include all the technology we developed on the ground for blocking out starlight. It will put it on an incredibly stable telescope in space, and it will be able to reach that actually 10 billion to one level that lets you see an Earth-like planet orbiting around a sun-like star. And so far as we know, that's the only technique that's going to get us there around stars that are like our own sun and get that real first Earth twin.
Yeah, it's very exciting. So Bruce and I are lucky enough to be part of a team of scientists who are helping lay out the science that this future mission will do, which will lead directly into what capabilities it will need and what technology will need to be developed. So it's a super exciting time to be like on the ground floor for this next big NASA flagship mission. So we talked about your least favorite fictional planet. Is there a fictional planet you'd really like to find? You know, how would you go about it?
But actually, I'm going to cheat on this, and they're not quite going to be planets. So one of my favorite science fiction authors is a British author named Ian Banks. Mm-hmm. And the civilization he describes doesn't actually live on planets because there are good ecological reasons you might not want to. If a planet has life on it, you don't want to bring humans. We see what we do to island ecosystems when we go there. So the civilization, which is called the Culture, which is a mature post-scarcity utopian civilization, mostly lives on space contracts, including things called orbitals that are sort of rings that are maybe about 1 million miles across, spin around, orbit around their sun, have vastly more surface area. And because they're an artificial environment, you're not like killing off local wildlife or something like that. Right. So looking for those kind of really advanced techno signatures is actually kind of one of the dreams of directions like to look for in fictionalized planets. And what would something like that, so different than a planet, look like?
What would the signature of a big ring like that around a star look like?
And transits actually would be an interesting way to look for that, because you'd get these sort of cool double dips as the both edges of the ring pass in front of the star in synchronization. And the Banks orbitals are big enough that you'd get transit signatures of 1% or something.
Okay.
So that combing through the Kepler catalog to see if you see those. Or
do
direct
they
imaging.
Infrared excesses the way like Dyson spheres would?
If you have enough of them, you'd start to see an excess of infrared. These are sort of on the scale of hypothetical giant science fiction-y things.
Okay.
These are much smaller than Dyson spheres, so they probably wouldn't dominate the infrared emission of their system.
Okay.
But direct imaging, they'd be pretty bright, too. So,
Exciting. Well, let's go look for rings, for constructs in space. It's time to answer some questions from the audience. We're so glad you're with us and curious about exoplanets. One question we got on a previous episode was, are all or most solar systems in our galaxy aligned in the same direction as ours? Bruce, what do you think?
I think, though I'm not an expert in this, that the evidence is no, that the orientations are kind of random. The systems we image, as you know, we have kind of a bias in how we find them, but we found ones, 8799 is tilted about 20 degrees with respect to the sun. We found one, Beta Pic, that's precisely edge on. We've found ones that are in between. So far as we know, they're just randomly oriented.
Yeah, but I can see why people would ask this question, because, you know, our solar system has lots of things that are lined up in the same plane. And our galaxy, which is a spiral galaxy of hundreds of billions of stars, has a bunch of things that are lined up in the same plane. But it turns out, if you look really closely at the physics, the scale of solar systems and the scale of the galaxy are so decoupled. So when you have a giant molecular cloud of dust and gas that collapses, any final momentum, any like spinning that the system does is just basically driven by the turbulence in that cloud and how that turbulence randomly aligned that day when it collapsed, and then you get something that spins. So different molecular clouds collapsing produce systems with different alignments, and they're happening all over the galaxy. So we see this very strong decoupling between the orbital planes of planetary systems and the orbital plane of the galaxy. So there's no reason to believe they should be lined up, and we see that they're not lined up. But it's a really good question, because we do see these alignments happen on many scales. So thank you, listener. And if you're listening, please send in your questions. Okay, thank you, everyone, for joining us. If you want more out-of-this-world astronomy content, please join us for our next episode. And like and subscribe, Explore Exoplanets. You can follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, where you can send us your burning questions about exoplanets, real or fictional, and beyond, for us to tackle in an upcoming episode. Thanks so much, Bruce, and bye, everyone.